know these things can be like real sensitive, depending on like the direction.
Yeah, I think I should try to probably turn on the turn off the fan. Because it picks up everything.
Yeah.
And here we go. Yeah, we're already recording, so we can go ahead and... Yeah, man. So what's up, Jacob? So today, guys, I'm ladies and gentlemen, people of all around the world. Today we have Jacob Berry from Main Street Downtown, Main Street Boxing Gym.
Yeah, Main Street Boxing and Muay Thai.
Yeah, Muay Thai. So I've been wanting to speak to Jacob about a month ago, I would say, about 2 months ago, a few months ago.
I think you originally, mentioned it. I didn't know it was, you mentioned it, but it was kind of in passing. I wasn't sure if it was like an invite or if it was like, oh, it'd be cool sometime. I was like, sure. You know, like people were always like, oh, we should get lunch sometime. You're like, yeah, it never really happened. So I was glad you hit me back up about doing it.
Sure. Yeah, because that day, I think I had some job interview or something. So I was like, let me go stop in Main Street. And then I've been wanting to stop into Main Street. So I stopped in, and obviously right there.
I'm always there.
I know, but it was awesome because I had already, like I said, I had already seen you, mm-hmm. you know, fighting on Fury and a few snippets here and there. And then they've been posting. And then, you know, and then, of course, Main Street I've been watching. And, you know, you're one of the guys in the upcoming, man. You're doing awesome.
Thanks, man.
And so when I saw that, I was like, oh, dude, Jacob. I was like, yeah, it's, or Jay Berry, right? Or
yeah, Jacob. Jacob's my name. Jay Bob is what I have listed everywhere. Jay Bob was a name that was given to me back when I was rodeoing.
Mm-hmm.
Back in like middle school and high school.
Yeah.
I went to one of the first rope and pins I'd go practice at. For some reason, this guy named Grady McGee, he sold a tractor salesman. Out of nowhere, the second day I was there, he called me J-Bob. Knew my name was Jacob, but called me J-Bob. And it just kind of stuck from that point on. My mom calls me that. Everyone from back home calls me that. Kind of stuck with me. So that's kind of what I go with.
So now I hit record. So now
we're recording.
Here we go.
Cool. Take two. It was a practice run. We're well rehearsed.
So here we are again. Like I said, here we are again with... another episode of Tristan Shop Talk, and then today we have Jacob Berry from Main Street Boxing
and Muay Thai.
Muay Thai.
Pumped to be here.
And then, just like you were saying, I knew you by your name. So that's initially where we're going to start from. But I knew your name from before because we were talking about how I had already seen you. I had a job interview, didn't get it or whatever. I stopped by Main Street and then I ran into you. And then boom, here we are, man.
Yeah,
definitely. Cool. You know,
I'm glad we're here. Glad we can make it happen. Make it happen.
But no, I know in the last my first question is, how long have you been training, and how long have you been involved in martial arts?
So my first taste of martial arts, I was probably 6 or 7. It's kind of a classic story of like, oh, I did karate when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
My mom put me in taekwondo, 6, 7 years old, and we did it for maybe a year, year and a half, something like that. But that was the only taste I had of martial arts for a long time.
Right.
And then I didn't do anything involving martial arts after that for years until I was a senior in high school. And I just was like a kid who's like out of shape, just needed something else to do. Something to kind of give me something to focus on.
Right.
And I found there was an MMA gym like half a mile from where I lived. And a tiny little gym, a little strip center. And that's where I started. And it was a MMA Muay Thai style gym. And I was 18 going on 19 whenever I first...
What part of town? And
so this is back home for me. So okay. I'm from a town called Cal Allen. It's a Robstown mailing address, but no one knows where that is. It's outside of Corpus Christi.
Oh, okay.
So it's a small town out there. That's where I started. And I was there... for, I guess, the first 4 or 5 years or so that I trained.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I got done with my undergrad studies, I came to Houston full time. And while I was going to school, anytime I had like, you know, spring break, summer break, winter break, stuff like that.
Right.
Instead of going with my friends and like going to the beach and partying and stuff, I'd come up to Houston mm-hmm. and Kru Bob from Main Street would let me stay at his house and train at the gym for a week. And that was kind of how I started coming up here. And then once I graduated my undergrad from Kingsville, I boogied on up here and have been here ever since.
Awesome, bro. Yeah. So you have your degree then?
I have 3 degrees.
You have 3 degrees?
Yeah, I have an associate in mechanical engineering, a bachelor's of business, and an MBA.
Congratulations, man.
Thanks.
Yeah, awesome. Awesome.
And I get punched in the face for a living. It's fantastic. I love it.
But that's almost like a Kobe story, man. So in your off time, like you said, like, well, your friends are out partying and doing things.
I was
things.
A homeschool kid. Yeah, didn't have any social skills. So what else was I going to do?
But I would say the town you were raised in was outside of Robstown?
Yeah. So think of Cypress to Houston.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what Corpus was to like where I grew up.
Yeah.
And then I say like if you look at the last Fury Fight, I think I listed like a hometown is Robstown because there's a Robstown mailing address.
Right.
Why? So the town was Robstown, but we lived in what we called Cal Island, which is a little bitty like school district area outside of Corpus. Yeah.
Because my family's from the Valley, so we traveled through there. So I know how small it is. Yeah. It's definitely like. I'm sure everybody knew everybody and it was that kind of small time atmosphere. So you were raised there from little.
From there till I was 23.
And then that's when you finished all your degrees.
That's why I came up here.
And then you came up here. But then even when you were doing your degrees, you said that during your downtime, instead of going and partying like normal college kids, you would come up here to Houston and train.
I come here and train in Houston. I stay with Kru Bob, my head coach, like my dad, and would come up and stay at his house and train at the gym and, you know, clean up at the gym, some do stuff like that. And then when I had to go back to school, I'd go back home.
And then how did you meet Mr. Perez?
So through my first coach.
Oh, okay.
So the gym is still there, KO Sports Training, and I think now it goes by Corpus Christi Muay Thai as well.
Mm-hmm.
I still have friends that train out there. And every time I go home, I'll pop in and spar with them sometimes, that group. He was a student of Kru Bob's.
Oh, wow.
And so I met Kru Bob through... I think the first time I ever met Kru Bob was actually a seminar that he did with Chase Corley in San Antonio.
Wow.
And then sometime after that, he actually came down to the gym I was at and did a seminar and did some privates and stuff like that. And that's how I got a real introduction to him.
Nice.
And got to train with him for the first time. That was years ago.
Nice. And then, of course...
And the rest is history.
Now I'm here. Awesome. Yeah. So then definitely you were using your time to come up here and train. So obviously from that time, was it initially that you had got into just Muay Thai from the get-go? Or was it like a little bit of boxing, a little bit of everything? Or was it just like you said?
The reason I got so hard into Muay Thai specifically was because I was doing MMA mainly at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, this was 7 years ago
or
so. My parents hate fighting.
Right.
Hated it. And at the time, like I was 19, 20 years old, and I was living with them, getting my undergrad, going to A&M Kingsville.
Yeah.
So I was staying at home. Like I had no money. I didn't have a real job, you know, like,
right.
So I kind of was like under their household. So I kind of had to be sneaky. So I couldn't fight locally. All the fights locally were MMA fights.
Right.
But small town stuff, like I couldn't do it secretly and get away with it. Mm-hmm. And every time I tried, like I'd get busted, like someone rat me out or they hear something. And it was really bad. They did not want me fighting. Like they threatened to kick me out of the house. So I'm not sure of my back. Like you can't fight basically. So to hide the fact that I was fighting, I did, Muay Thai primarily because there's no Muay Thai in Texas. Now there is. Shout out to Texas Muay Thai Championship, Jonathan Harris and Bobby Peak and them.
Yeah.
Great show. Awesome, awesome platform for amateurs and pros in the region to want to do Muay Thai. They just had a show last weekend. Phenomenal. Shout out to them. But at the time, there's nothing. There's nothing to do for Muay Thai in Texas. But there was a lot of opportunities like outside, like in other parts of the country.
Yeah.
And so what we would do is we would travel to like Oklahoma and a lot to like Iowa, where these big tournaments were to compete. And I was going as like a teammate. I was holding pads. I was just kind of being there to help, being support, like
hang out with
my friends. And I could go up there and no one would know anything.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a big tournament. No one's posting me on social media. No one knows me there. No one knows anybody knows my
family. What year was this?
This was, let's see, let me think. I graduated, going backwards in my head, it's not working. This would have been like 4 or 5 years ago or so.
Oh, wow.
This would have been like, I came up here in 2019. Mm-hmm. So I won my last TBA title the summer of 2019. So it would have been 2019, 2018, 17. Those were the years that this was taking place primarily. Right. And basically, I would fly or travel to out of the state
right.
and fight. And I just couldn't get my ass kicked and I'd be fine.
Right.
You know, as long as I didn't come back with like a beat up face and injuries and stuff, no one would know any better. And they may have known or had an idea, but no one said anything. So just let it go. So that is why I got so invested in Muay Thai and did so much there, because my parents wouldn't let me fight. And was trying to sneak around and trying to fight. That's all I could do it.
Yeah.
And so that's why I got so heavily into that. And then whenever I came to Houston, then it didn't matter. I was on my own. I was out of the house. I could do say whatever I wanted to.
Right.
And then I focused primarily on MMA. MMA from there. So.
So when you were younger, no fights or nothing like that?
I've never been in a fight. I've got 22, 23 fights or so now.
Yeah.
I've never been in a fight outside of a ring or a cage.
Wow.
Ever.
Awesome.
Never. I am not a...
No, reason I'm saying that, but like, you know, some guys, they come from like heavy cardio type of, you know, when they were younger or I'm sure you're just not like me. A normal... No, always, but I mean, but I mean, even think about it. I mean, I feel like even living in that town, I mean, you're probably outside... Constantly running around doing things.
I was a country kid who was outside in the dirt every day growing up. I did rodeo and horses, so I was always dealing with horse stuff like that.
Yeah, so you were an active person.
Then,
though.
Oh, I was very active.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Yeah. And then so that's what I was just trying to
also,
get.
Also, and I played general sports like football and basketball and stuff. I was terrible at them, but I did those. And then I did motocross for a long time.
Yeah.
I rode dirt bikes for a long time too. So I was an active kid. I was always into doing something physical. And competing and challenging and stuff like that. Nothing fight related.
Yeah, but I mean, that definitely lines up what I was getting at. Like, I knew definitely you were either probably like hands on or something like that.
Yeah.
And then like when like you said, you probably found your niche. You're like, damn, man, I like this.
I was outside.
This is awesome. Like
doing something active all the time growing up as a kid. Even working, like my dad had me working and doing stuff ever since I was young. It was always active, you know, sweating in the heat.
Yeah,
outside. That's kind of how.
No, and then, I mean, dude, that's when I see eye to eye on that one, because same thing with my, like I explained to you, my dad's a Vietnam vet and kicked me on Saturday. Hey, get up, get in the morning.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's almost like you're channeling that same discipline towards, of course, what you like, what you want to do, and then it's the same type of, you know, you have no problem getting your hands dirty. You have no problem. You might go home and like you're aching. Some people, they go home, they're like, man, you know, they complain about aches and this and that. And it's like, yo, man, that's the fun of it. You know?
Yeah. It's different strokes for different folks. You know, some people, you know, I have people around me that I love and they're like, they want to sit inside and like read books and look at art. And that's awesome. They do that. That's fantastic for them. You know, I like a little bit more stimuli.
Yeah.
You know?
And then that's what I was just getting at. But then also, damn, motocross too, huh?
Yeah, awesome. Which is why, you know, and we always talk about this, and I bring up the story about my parents, is because, like, I played football, all kinds of sports, football. I was on dirt bikes when I was 6 years old, which are basically one-way tickets to the hospital. Like, they keep Halo Flight in business.
Yeah.
Like, they're bad. Horses, of course, like,
no, I worked in the ER, so.
Oh, yeah.
So I worked at the Life Flight, so, like, the Life Flight. We would always get randomly drops from, where are you from? And it would be like somewhere south, either mid Texas.
Yeah.
Like a good, you know, less than 150 miles of something, you know, like you said, things like that. Exactly like that.
Yeah. No, so I've always done stuff like that. You know, it kind of transition. But what's funny though, is, you know, we talked about me, fighting and not being any fights growing up as a kid.
Yeah.
I was raised to be an absolute pansy.
Yeah.
I was told, if you have any issues, go to your parents. Like, you come get my mom's, like, you come get me. You don't do it. Like, I was, yeah. That's how I was raised, to be just soft. Like this kid that was like their parents. And this is on me to talk about my parents. I love my parents. They did, they did a good job. I had a roof over my head. I had a lot of cool things, but yeah. I had a lot of toys. Like, you know, we all have our complaints, right?
Mm-hmm.
My parents are great and they're great now. But that's how I was raised. So growing up, I didn't know if I was made of glass or not. You know, mm-hmm. So it's crazy to me. Like, if I were to go back to 15-year-old Jacob and show him what I do now, he'd shit himself. There's no way, you know, like it was, and I think that's part of why I got so intrigued by it, is once you realize, oh, you're not made of glass, and like,
yeah,
you can do this, and like, it's not that bad, and you can do something that very few people, other people are willing to do, like,
yeah,
it's definitely really invigorating, you know?
Yeah, definitely. But I mean, even what you were saying though, like, I still feel like, my parents came from a small town. So, I mean, I relate, like, cause I got to live with my grandparents when I was younger. So I honestly believe, like, I feel like when you're raised in a small town like that, like, it kind of like, and it's kind of, you know, kind of gets you, I mean, you're a child needs to be kind of not exposed to so much, you know?
Yeah.
So I feel it's like, kind of like when you were growing up, you know, you, like I said, you just gravitated just naturally, you know?
Yeah.
And then boom, you know, after that, you know, you kind of fell into something that was based on everything else that you kind of resonated with. But then when you came into that, you felt at home and you're like, yeah, hell yeah. You're like, man, I can defend myself. I can do this. Yeah. I can do that.
There's definitely a lot of things that, like, looking back on my childhood, I think about now where I'm at, and I think, oh, that makes sense. That all kind of works out to where I end up where I am.
Boom, Muay Thai, you're like you said, you're going up to out of state, helping out, holding the pads, doing all this, you know, it's like you're saying, being part of the team, being a mm-hmm. team player. And then when was your first fight? Do you remember that?
I had my first fight probably a year after training, 8 months after training, something like that, mm-hmm. like a smoker fight. My first actual MMA fight was maybe a year and a half in.
Mm-hmm.
I remember, I fought like 170. I was like way undersized. The wow. guy I fought was like, you know, just this long, lanky kid. And yeah. I don't remember anything from the fight. I don't remember after it at all. Like, it's one of those things I always explain to the guys we have that make their debuts. Whenever you have your first fight, like, you don't remember anything. Your adrenaline is so high that you can't process what's going on. You can't think. You just kind of go.
Right.
You either go or you don't, and you mm-hmm. freeze. I remember I won that fight by decision. That was my first fight. And then I did some Muay Thai fights in between there and tournaments and stuff like that. Then on my second amateur fight, like maybe a year later, and I got my ass kicked for 10 minutes.
Oh, wow.
In an MMA fight. I fought a guy. It was a short notice replacement. I'm pretty sure the promoter kind of like tried to bamboozle us on who we're actually fighting.
Yeah.
But I didn't care. Just put me, you know, just you fight whoever. Something. I got the brakes beat off of me for 10 minutes. Didn't go down. I never that's when I realized I was tough. And that's kind of what I go back to. Anytime I fight now, or even when I was in school, I had to do a presentation or mm-hmm. anything, or it's a podcast, you know, like anything I ever do, I always think back to myself. I'm like, it's not going to be worse than that day in Sinton, Texas, when I think the guy's name was Josh Rogers. He's still fighting, I believe.
Oh, wow.
That's a pro now. Beat my face in for 10 minutes and covered the mat red. That's kind of when I learned that I wasn't made of glass, could actually take a shot.
Yeah, man. That's pretty strong, which, you know, I mean, so you, but how far away from was that fight from the, did you say was from the first one you said?
Like a year, I think.
A year?
I don't remember they're all on Tapology. I don't remember the dates, but I think it was about a year later I had that fight. I think I had some Muay Thai fights in between there.
Yeah. So do you think it was more just like, I guess, yeah, the guy was just better at the time, or
was definitely better at the time. I was terrible. He was definitely better at the time for sure. But it's one of those things. Like, I learned a lot going into that fight about, I went into that fight not really knowing who I was as a fighter. And I went in trying to be super amped up and aggressive and like was trying to take his head off. And that's not me as a person. I'm not that guy. I'm a very like, I'm chill. Like I fight calm. Like I'm more the one who's going to like want to hang out and get a beer with my opponent before we fight and after we fight. Like not, I'm not going to mean mug. And I was trying to, I was still trying to figure out who I was as a competitor, as a fighter at the time. And I went into that fight just so tensed and amped up, and you can't fight that way. I can't fight that way.
Yeah.
And I was just freezing and just waiting to hit him. And all he would do is he'd move and he'd move and he'd move and then he'd stop and then jump in and crack me and then move and move and move. And he'd stop and jump in and crack me. 'Cause I was just standing there just trying to walk him down. That's what happened in that fight.
So he was that. Pretty much had figured you out pretty quickly.
Yeah, well, it was a matter of experience.
Yeah.
It was a matter of me not having experience and me trying to, so really learning how to fight and how to go throughout the fight. And he had more experience than I did, and he used it, and he beat me with it. You know, which was, it taught me a lot about how, and I still think about it when I fight now. You know, wherever I get nerves or get anxious or get emotions with the fight, like I know where I need to be whenever I go in there. And I know where I can't be because I know where it can be detrimental to me.
I mean, I don't know, this makes that kind of weird if I'm going to say it, but I feel just like your energy level has to be right. Everything has to be like right for yourself. You know, like you were saying, like you as a person, like you got to be checked out on all the boxes that you feel that you feel as yourself.
Yeah.
And that comes with training. That comes with accountability comes with, a lot. You know,
it comes with a lot. And
a
lot of experience too. Like I kind of had a reminder of it. I had my second pro fight I lost because I did something very similar. I tried to take the guy's head off, and when it didn't work, I got very frustrated and kind of got just overzealous and got clipped and got cracked by a dude that was bigger than I was that put me on my ass. You know, like it's good to be reminded of those things sometimes. You know, because some people want to go in and fight, and they want to be that way. Some people are so calm and relaxed that they look like they're about to take a nap.
Yeah,
like they just don't seem like they care at all. And I can't do that either. You know, you got to kind of find, especially in your early fights when you're amateur, kind of find who, how you fight, and you're like what you state of mind need to be in pre-fight, and how to kind of prepare yourself for the event. You know, it just takes experience.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, the only thing I could bring to light that can even compare to what you go through would be just like, just serve when I served, you know, just not making mistakes. You know, of course, if you made a mistake, it might cost the military money
or like somebody's life. The stakes are way higher with that than fighting for sure.
No. But I'm saying like when it comes down to it, I mean, I feel it's still like, yourself being, you know, it's
yeah,
like it's you putting yourself in that cage. It's you, you know, you're the one that's there for the, you know, we're just there for the entertainment, you know.
Yeah.
So I always respect a fighter who goes into the cage. He's in that cage. He knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
Obviously, if the cage is, I mean, if he's in that cage and like you said, like if he's not lined up right, if he doesn't know what's going, you know, if he's not doesn't feel. That can kind of compromise your thinking when you're in there, you know, when you fumble or you get into a tight spot, you're like, oh shit, I didn't think he was going to do this.
Yeah.
And then you're like, you think a little too much and then boom, boom, it's already too late.
Yeah.
And then, so I like that. That's where I relate because I feel like every fighter, you have to think about, like, you have to think like that. I mean, when we watch you guys go in there and girls, and y'all are going through some, it can go one way or it can go the other way.
It's a lot. And then when the cage door shuts, you don't know which way it's going to go. Like, you know, you talked about kind of adapting and like they come out and it's like they do something different than what you expected and just being able to prepare for it. Like the last guy I fought did not fight like we thought he was going to fight. Like he was a tougher opponent than what we expected. We got in there, as soon as the fight started, he started pushing forward and I thought he was gonna go back. I thought he was gonna kind of give some ground and kind of wait. And as soon as we kind of came to the center, he was starting to push into me and try and find his range fast.
Yeah.
And it definitely changed. You have to kind of adapt.
Yeah.
You know,
but then with your experience.
Yeah. I'm thankful to have fought as much as I have fought and to have had the rounds of the gym I've had, you know, like, to get me prepared for it. Cause whenever we realized, hey, we're in a real fight, this guy's come to fight. Like he's here to make you work. You know, it was something that we can go, okay, cool. Switch into this mode. And we're here for three rounds now, you know? So
how long ago was that one?
That was April 24th.
April 24th. Okay.
No, that's a lie. September 24th. April was the one before.
Okay.
So,
you're mixing up your fights.
Yeah, I know.
that's funny.
I got my fights, but then like I'm always like, we got so many amateur guys fighting, and like every week is something fight related for me. I'm always going somewhere for fights, so.
I bet. And then dates. It's on.
So it was about 3 weeks a month ago. It was September 24th, I believe was the date on that one.
That was like just because I had saw that one, and from what I saw from the excerpts was a lot of leg kicks.
There were a lot of leg kicks. Yeah, I mean,
you found the distance, and I just saw you take advantage, like boom, boom.
Yeah, boom. I love my leg kicks. I love kicking anything. Yeah. Well, and before. Kind of go back to the Muay Thai thing.
Yeah.
You know, my Muay Thai titles and all my Muay Thai fights, I won a lot of those by kicking and clinching.
Yeah.
I could not box to save my life. When I first came to Houston, I had no hands. My hands were terrible. Like, I would just get smashed by boxers in the gym. Like, I just couldn't hang. And now I've spent a lot of time improving my boxing, right?
Yeah.
And I'm glad I've done that, because now I feel very confident, comfortable with my hands.
Yeah.
But I'll always, if you give me a leg, I'm going to kick it. If you give me a leg, I'm going to kick it as many times as I possibly can.
I mean, when I was training at Paradigm, man, that's the only thing that saved me was my legs.
Yeah.
Because I have long legs.
Yeah.
And that's the, like, some of the times those guys came with more power from upper body.
Mm-hmm.
And I have the length, but I don't have a lot of upper body. But yeah. Like I said, I don't know. I just know I would result with either kicks or just push off. And then I would see the hesitation on them. Like, oh, damn, he's coming with a kick. Oh, damn.
Yeah.
You know, of course, because I feel that kicks are a lot stronger than punches, you know.
They definitely have. I mean, you've got a much larger limb,
mm-hmm.
you know, traveling at speed. It hurts. Yeah, you know, that's the only thing, going back to the fight in September, that's the only thing I did that I could tell the guy didn't like
mm-hmm.
was the left body kick.
Oh no, I remember seeing him. He was just you saw him bend this way, you saw him bend that way.
That's the only thing. Everything else though, that guy ate without a care in the world. Elbows, punches, he was there and was not going anywhere. The only time I ever saw any look on his face of like I didn't like that was the kick, which is why I kept kind of go back to it.
And then didn't you do a back kick?
I threw at the end of the first round.
I think you landed on that one.
I missed by this
one. Oh, did you?
Yeah, I kind of hit him with the side of my foot later in the second round, but it was kind of like a halfway. I kind of abandoned it midway through the spin because I felt like I wasn't going to miss it. And so I kind of halfway slapped him with it because I felt the positioning was off.
Yeah.
But in the first round, I threw it just to try and be fancy, you know.
It looked cool,
like a spinning wheel kick.
Because like you, I remember you were getting him on here, and then all of a sudden you're like, and then you flipped around. I was like, oh damn! And then I was like, do you get him or do you not?
my goal is obviously I want to try and finish people and knock people out. But if I can't do that, I want to at least be really fun to watch.
Yeah,
you know. So like, because I love the fight. I'm also a massive fight fan. I'm a fight nerd. I will talk about fights and fighters and styles all day long. So as a fight fan, as a fight nerd, I want to watch entertaining fights and I want to watch entertaining styles. So I try really hard. If I can't go out there and knock somebody out quick, I'm going to try and at least make the fight fun to watch for everyone that's watching it.
When I had Donovan Manuel in here, I explained to him, you know, because I'm in my 40s, so like, I mean, my dad, parents, like I said, the story, pay for the pay-per-view, they would go leave, and then we'd be ready for a fight,
mm-hmm.
and then one round, boom, done, over.
Yeah, yeah.
And that happened a few times, more than a few times.
Yeah, and happens a lot.
Yeah, and then you know, and then I go off this crazy conspiracy theory that Mike Tyson, I feel, was just too good. He was just too good to be even, I mean, nobody added up.
Yeah.
And then my thing is that maybe they just threw things in front of him just to make him falter and temp and more temptation than he normally would have had. Or, I mean, I'm sure he had temptation all over.
The thing is, if anyone who is, one, anyone who is at that level, making that much money, having that much success, like it, you can only do it for so long. Like you can't do it forever, right? We've seen it with every great athlete, every great fighter. Also, and Kru Bob was talking about this, fighters are crazy. Like fighters typically do things to extremes, you know? So a lot of times, you know, you have fighters like the Volkanovskis and Khabibs and stuff like that who are extreme, and they're going to train and they're going to stay disciplined and they're going to work and they're going to do make, you know, they're going to be responsible. Like that's how they are. Then you have other guys who are wild, you know, who are extreme in that way too.
Yeah.
So I think that happens a lot. Guys kind of get up and they get big and then they,
yeah, they
life around them, you know, you got, it's a lot to take in, you know?
I mean, even now, I mean, I can even say now, you know, I mean, even like, I mean, that's of course why I'm interested in you, because I always feel like a fighter starting off from the beginning. I mean, I think that's the most interesting part of all, because you got to come up, you know, and then you jump in and then you can just, hey, ask a few questions and say, hey, I mean, I think any fighter are, you know, but I mean, definitely like you, I give much respect because like I said, you get in the cage. So yeah, it takes a certain person to have to take that mentality, like you're like Coach, you know, Coach Perez said, you know, like definitely there's different personality traits that are needed to make that leap, you know?
Yeah, it's an extraordinary thing to like get. Even that's why it drives me absolutely crazy. You have guys who, and everyone talks about this, right? This is not a new point, not a hot mic or nothing like that.
Yeah.
The people who, and you'll hear it, you go to a Fury show, you'll hear it. People who have never fought, never trained, never wrestled, never boxed, done jiu-jitsu, ever. And they want to shit talk fighters in a cage for fighting. And don't get me wrong, there are some people who fight who are terrible.
Yeah.
There are some who are terrible.
Yeah.
But they have the guts and the balls to get into a cage in front of a... It's a nerve-wracking experience. It's terrifying. Anyone who says it's not is insane or lying. Like it's a crazy thing to go through. Get in this cage with someone else trying to take your head off in front of all these people and these lights and they're screaming. It's such an intense experience that like you have to respect anybody at in some capacity. You have to respect anybody who is willing to get into that kind of situation.
No, exactly.
And attempt it. You know, it's a tough thing to do.
And then that goes, I feel that kind of reflects on the world we live in now, you know, everybody's such a critic on some things that they don't,
that's just, you know, people,
yeah,
you know,
then, yeah, like, and then people, you know, like I said,
just,
yeah,
just
yeah,
people in general, you know, everyone likes to armchair quarterback, you know, I'm sure I do it too at different things, you know,
yeah.
I try not to, but I'm sure we're all guilty of it.
But yeah, I mean, and then, so, how many days a week do you train?
About six days a week. I make myself, well, I say this, I try to make myself take a day off.
Yeah.
Because, and do nothing. Because I know my body and I have to give it some time to recover for at least a day. But usually about 6 days a week. I try and at least 6 days a week do something.
Yeah.
Even if I'm not in camp, like do some shadow boxing workouts, like do line drills, do some bag work, you know, not going to go spar every day or do hard rolls every day, but just, you know,
move. As long as you're staying active.
Yeah, stay active.
And
I think those are the times too, whenever you're having a light day, you're just trying to rest this week and have, those are the best times to work on fundamentals, basic footwork, the boring stuff that people don't want to do. You know, those are the best times to work on those things, because you can rest and not be your body down, but be constructive and still improve your game that whole time.
Because I'm that was another thing I'm getting at too as well. So now you're instructing, obviously.
Yeah.
So now you're an instructor downtown.
Yeah.
And then I believe it's you, Coach Perez.
Yeah, so the amateur Muay Thai program, Kru Bob taught beginner Muay Thai for years and years and years, years. And beginning of last year, he gave it over to me and Paul Garza. And Paul fights for Fury. Paul's one of my good buddies.
Yes.
I train with him today. And so me and Paul are the ones that kind of head up the kind of beginner Muay Thai, amateur Muay Thai program at the gym. You know, but even in camp, I'm doing that. You know, I'll take off like 5 week Mm-hmm. I'll step away and have Paul cover everything, and vice versa. When he's on fight week, I'll cover his classes for him and stuff. But we do that, and then like I also like help out a lot of the amateur guys who are coming up. We got so many fires at the gym.
No, I see. It's
packed. Yeah. Like we'll have 50 people on just a normal morning sometimes in the gym training. It is packed.
Wow.
So we have so many, and so yeah. Kru Bob, he's only one person. Yeah. His own life as well.
Yeah.
And so he, some of us guys who are pros and coming up and stuff like that, we really get a chance to help with the amateurs and kind of, you know, corner and build them up and give them advice and stuff like that. Like this weekend, I'm cornering a couple amateurs for Fury.
Yeah. That's
funny enough, actually, yeah. I'm cornering against Paul in one of our fights because Paul also coaches at Paradigm,
mm-hmm.
Muay Thai at Paradigm.
Yeah.
And he is cornering one of their fighters, and then one of our fighters is fighting that fighter. So we're going to be at opposite corners from each other in the cage.
Well, no, because a few of the smokers, I remember Malik would switch over from side
yeah.
to side.
Yeah.
And yeah. It was just kind of funny because I think a few people were like, yo, is Malik with Mainstream or is he with us?
Yeah.
And then I would go from there.
one ring and they hung up.
But yeah, I remember he would switch over from side to side. Yeah. And I hate to say it, I mean I definitely am interested in Main Street.
Man, come and check us out. It's a cool gym,
yeah,
man.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
It's a cool, like it's like the land of misfit toys, is that what it is? It's everyone's super cool. It's like a no drama environment. Everyone's really welcoming. Everyone's cool. Like it's a happy place. Like it's definitely, I never want to like tell everyone, like leave where they're at. Like wherever you're happy and wherever you're like, get what you need. But it's definitely a place. Like if someone's looking for a home, it's a great, I love it. It's home for me.
Yeah.
For
well,
sure.
I mean, at my point now, I just have to say, I feel it's good for a person just to move. Like kind of see where they, I don't know. Like I said, yeah. Like definitely I need to get back into it. I was doing it at Paradigm, but the thing is, it's just like, it's just tough getting down there, you know?
Yeah.
And then live, yeah. like we were saying earlier, you know, life happens and this,
yeah.
and that, you know,
I think that no matter where someone goes to train at, you need to be somewhere you can grow.
Mm-hmm.
And, somewhere that is going to be a net benefit to you just in general, just in life, you know, like
yeah.
you need to be around a place you can grow, a place you can learn, you know, like if you're the best dog in the room, then like, you know, you can kind of reach ceiling sometimes.
Yeah.
So that's definitely one aspect of it, but also to just be around people that you can, that care and that you love and that are going to make you a better person because, you know, I'm in the gym. I see the people, my friends in the gym every single day.
Yeah.
You know, like I see Kru Bob and Paul more than I see my girlfriend during the week.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm in the gym all day with them.
Right.
So the people you're around are going to be a massive influence on you, whether you know it or not.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's really important to kind of keep that in mind whenever you're surrounding yourself with any group of people. You know, so
yeah.
I think if someone's at a gym and they love it there and they're happy and they love the people there and they feel welcome and they feel like they're learning, then that's where they need to be.
No, I'm definitely getting back into it. Like when I started training with Coach G, it was during COVID, and I took advantage of the time because at the time there was less classes.
Yeah.
So I took major advantage of. I mean, I had one-on-ones, a lot of one-on-ones. Wasn't that many people to spar with, but it was fun. And then
yeah.
as things started progressing, then I getting more and more, and then I started getting more into it. And then I still didn't make time to train. You know, I still wanted to make time to train. So I was just like, whatever. But what I'm saying is that Muay Thai is hardcore, man. It's a lot of cardio.
Yeah.
So as in your workouts, do you do a lot of running? Do you do a lot of different things to keep yourself? Because, I mean, I just know you have to be very lean in a sense.
Yeah. So, I Muay Thai and MMA training is a little bit different in that sense than cardio. Muay Thai will run a lot more to kind of condition the legs. MMA is more of a sprinter pace.
Uh-huh.
Muay Thai is more of a constant kind of steady pace. typically, like it's all fighting, you know. Cardio is cardio. Like, cardio is good.
Yeah.
I, at one point in time, when I first started training, I didn't know how to cope. I didn't know what I was doing. Uh-huh. I was averaging 10 miles a day, 5 days a week.
10 miles?
Yes. Which was way too much. Way too much.
Were you making up, I mean, your calories?
No, I just didn't know any better. Like, I didn't. I knew I had to run.
You're very lean then, huh? You're real lean then.
I can eat a lot.
Wow.
Yeah. So yeah. I was leaner. I was smaller for sure, but it wasn't. It really wasn't. It was too much. It was kind of beating too much. Yeah. And also too, I'm dumb. I would run like thinking that like I'm pushing myself. I'd run the hottest part of the day in South Texas heat. It was ridiculous. Now I will do when I'm towards the last 4 weeks of camp.
Uh-huh.
I'll run. Really pretty much 5 days a week, mm-hmm. but I'll run like 4 miles, three miles. And then I'll do maybe 3 miles on a treadmill. And then I'll do like half an hour, 20 minutes on a bike.
Yeah.
You know, just lower impact, more constant kind of cardio and stuff. Not doing sprints. I'm not, because we train so hard in the gym.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's, that gets you in shape.
Yeah.
Like we don't have guys that gas in fights because the pace that we use in the gym is so nuts.
Yeah.
And it's hot in the gym. We basically live in a 100-year-old brick oven is what it is.
Yeah.
The AC's never on. So it's 120 degrees. It's hot. It's muggy. You can't breathe. You're training at a crazy pace. So most of my cardio, I would say, is from training.
Yeah.
From training in the gym, sparring, situational training, hard drills, pads, stuff like that. I run and do extra cardio outside of it mainly for weight.
Yeah.
Mainly to weight, for weight, especially going to 45 now. Get my legs kind of trimmed down a little bit, get the last like fat off, get some muscle off my thighs and kind of get the weight lower. That's the main reason I do so the running.
Yeah.
But I don't run like I used to. I hate running. I don't like it. Nothing wrong with it. I just don't enjoy it. I
hate it too, but I feel like it's the best way to kind of just, like you said, just get to the, you know, just get that good workout, you know?
Yeah.
So usually I'll get out of there
Running's always a good thing to do. If you need to work out, want to like burn some calories and it's great for you. It helps your heart, helps your lungs.
Mm-hmm.
Like long distance running is phenomenal. And also too, as like people, like we're evolved to run.
Yeah.
You know, like we have the best long distance running capabilities of better long distance running capabilities of any other animals on the planet. So like we're built to run, you know, so it's a good thing to.
It's just sad a lot of people don't do it.
a lot of people don't do anything though. You know?
Yeah, like, that's another issue.
A lot of
people
don't do anything. Yeah. You know, it's always a good resource to have, you know, and it's a good thing too. Like if you need to cut weight, go run.
We're going to go run.
Like it's always there.
So I traveled to Thailand, and man, dude, when I was there, I didn't go see Muay Thai.
You didn't?
No, because during the time, that's when I was, man, I wasn't even in the right mind. But I didn't know if you ever, because that's another thing I was going to get into, but did you ever plan on possibly going over there?
So I want to go so bad.
Yeah.
We were trying to plan to go right before COVID happened.
Mm-hmm.
Like as before COVID happened, me and Kru Bob were like, let's plan this trip. Let's go to Thailand for a month or so. Let's go fight. And then before we could get anything actually ironed out and like start booking things, getting the itinerary planned or like getting logistics covered,
boom.
COVID hit
and
shut everything down. So I was like, well, never mind. So I really want to go.
Yeah.
I want to go for like a month and train for 3 weeks and fight and then enjoy a week of just being in Thailand or something like that. You know, I really, really want to go. Right now, first, like utmost importance is my MMA career.
Yeah. Right.
So it's going to have to, it probably won't be in the next couple of years because my next year, my focus is hitting it hard and making next year really count.
Yeah.
And get the fights I need to get in when I need to get them in.
Yeah.
So that's my priority right now. But whenever I can, I definitely want to make a trip over there.
And see, I regret it, man, because I would be in the streets, and then they have these actual bot buses with like
it's almost like a truck with the platform in the back, and then they have the Muay Thai fighters.
Yeah.
And yeah, and then they're there just like kind of, you know, playing around advertising for the fights.
Yeah.
And then at the time we were like, yo, maybe we'll make it over there. Never made it, man. Yeah. And then so now I've traveled through Asia, and yeah, definitely now I'm you know, that's, you know, I don't know, I guess priorities change for me. I mean, that's why I respect what you were saying earlier, like how you were saying that, you know, well, instead of friends going out drinking, I was those friends going out and drinking.
Most people are, yeah.
Took me a while to learn that that's not where all the fun's at, and that's not usually, you know, how things should be. But now I know if I ever go back to take advantage of, you know, just take advantage of things like that, yeah. Seeing things. So now definitely I'm on this road of, like, hopefully, man, get back to Muay Thai, man, because like I said, I see what, like, the stuff y'all do, and it's just, I mean, I just love the workout. I love a Muay Thai workout, because the Muay Thai workout is, like you said, it's just a lot of pads. Well, I mean, when I used to do it there, Paradigm was just definitely pads with other people, straight 3 minute every, what, three, I would get 3 workouts, 3 minute per sessions, I think.
Yeah.
And then we would switch over to the other. Yeah. And then we'd go back. And then, ooh, I would sleep like a baby at night.
It's,
you know,
a great full body kind of workout. I have a client. We call him Doc. He's a medical doctor. He's in the business side now. And he's 63, 64 now. And his son's training at the gym. And I do Muay Thai with him and pads and stuff like that. And he loves it.
Yeah.
For some reason, it's just a great, great full body workout, build muscle, cardio, like learn skills. Like, it's a great.
Yeah. I think it's just, I don't know. Like I said, it's just a nice exit for me, because I used to look, I mean, I just, those workouts are just so, like I said, you feel so fresh after that. Like after, you know, and then of course you have interaction with another person, and of course you got to come up with to help their person out. And then you're learning so much from them, and they're learning so much from you.
Yeah.
I love the whole aspect of it. It's awesome.
You said you've been all over Asia. Have you been in Japan?
No.
You haven't been in Japan?
Okay, no, cool. I haven't been in Japan.
I was going to ask what it was like compared to Thailand.
No, I've been to Beijing. I lived in Beijing.
Mm-hmm.
I've been to Hong Kong. I've visited Malaysia. I've visited Singapore, and I've visited Thailand twice. Thailand,
that's
which was
cool.
Before the Navy, and then Thailand, which is after or during the Navy. And of course, before the Navy, it was way more funner. But I mean, overall, like Thailand was just, man, it was just like beautiful weather. I mean, the best place I would say was Phi Islands. And it was just like these islands from Phuket. And it's just like a getaway. It's like away from all, like I'm sure you saw like in Japan, maybe a lot of markets. And
Yeah. It's all markets.
And see, Thailand, Bangkok, like Phuket, a lot of those places are like that. And it's just, you know,
it's a touristy section.
Yeah, touristy, a lot of prostitutes, all that crap. And then, like, you get away from that and you go to, like, Phi Phi Islands and you're like, oh my God.
You're out in the country.
Yeah, like, you're out in the country.
Yeah.
And then it's almost just like, I don't know, it's almost like looking into, like, a TV screen, man. It's just like, when you look out there, it's just gorgeous.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, so when I went, it was like 2006. And then I went again in 2010 or 11 to Thailand. And then I want to go back. But like you said, it definitely would take a good time out of your schedule.
Yeah, it's a big commitment. I've friends who gone over there. You got to dedicate. If you're going to go, you got to go for like a month, like a few weeks, you know, to make it really worth your while to go out there.
But see, also, there's another gentleman, I don't know what's the name of, he opened up, but he opened up another one in Cancun, I hear now. There's a Muay Thai. This guy opened up a gym, I believe it was in Thailand, and I guess gathered so much attention from it, he was able to open up more gyms in like spots like that. And it's almost like ideally like tourist spots, which would be, and then from what I hear, and I need to look it up, but it'd be Cancun. I know there's one there. And I know a lot of Americans go there to, like, you know, I guess to just train for a little bit.
A lot of, like you're talking about, like, Phuket and a lot of those other cities. Like, a lot of the gyms there are for, foresters. For touristers. Foreigners.
I combined
two words into one. Foresters out there. The National Forest Committee's over the time. you know, a lot of it is a lot of the touristy. I've never been, but I've heard, you know, Kru Bob's been a whole bunch of stuff like that. I've heard a lot about it. And there are other gyms kind of tucked away, you know, that are smaller, invite only and stuff, that are the real, like, stadium gyms and stuff like that.
So I'm hoping, but see, and then, I mean, I know it's come up quite a bit, but like we don't have, I don't know if I'm saying it right, 1FL or 1FC?
1FC.
1FC.
Mm-hmm.
And I know 1FC concentrate a lot on Muay Thai.
They use a lot of Muay Thai.
A lot of Muay Thai.
Yeah.
And then you got UFC, which is American.
All MMA. Yeah.
And then I know it's a big debate, and I'm bringing up the debate because the debate, I feel, man, I love to watch Muay Thai. And then, I mean, you see that there's people that love Muay Thai.
Yeah.
It's an exciting sport.
It is one of the most exciting sports to watch, period. Favorite combat sports. Like, it is the most, it is everything that MMA is, except for the parts that casuals hate, which is the laying and praying, jujitsu, you know, I love it because I'm a fight nerd, and
I love all types of fighting. Yeah, of course.
But most people just want to see you hit each other.
Yeah.
Muay Thai is nothing. You can hit each other any range, kicking, punching, elbows. There's nowhere safe. You know, there's no safe range in Muay Thai. It just hasn't. I think it's starting to come here now that 1FC is starting to put more national stage.
Yeah.
Because it's big in like Europe. Muay Thai and kickboxing is big over there.
No, it is.
It just, I don't think it's had the right backing here to grow. And I'm hoping, as far as MMA goes, I think that UFC has a much better product than 1FC, personally.
Mm-hmm.
But what 1FC has done is they've brought in some of the best kickboxers and Muay Thai fighters from all over the world. And that product is amazing. The kickboxing fights and Muay Thai fights they put on are phenomenal. Like, they're great to watch. And so I'm hoping now that they are kind of get more commercial popularity, and they're starting to do shows in the US now, that it will kind of grow. The little people go, like, what is this? Who's Rod Tang? Who is, you know, what is this? Muay Thai,
that last fight,
kickboxing.
Yeah, that was crazy.
Yeah, that was fun to watch. And then also, too, like I said earlier, just in Texas, you know, Texas Muay Thai Championship that Bobby Peak and Jonathan Harrison are running. It's itself is growing shows Muay Thai here in just the state. And like, that's what's going to happen is we need it to become big on the commercial level where people are seeing it on TV and online and it's trending.
Mm-hmm.
But we also need to have a way for it to grow grassroots level as well. You can build up fighters, and then that way as people start to learn about it, and they go, oh wait, they have these fighters, these Muay Thai fights here, and like, oh, that guy's from my city and he fights Muay Thai and now he's fighting on this. Like, I think it's happening. I think it's taking time, but I think it's going to start growing in the US. I hope so.
I agree. I hate to throw another crazy conspiracy, but I feel
all the conspiracies you want.
No, I feel it's the boxing promotions that kind of kill it. Because I think if anything, it's going to bring, they don't want to lose boxing in America. And I understand that, but there's a lot of other different avenues.
They've
now
already lost boxing.
And it's, even after.
In America is starting to definitely.
I mean,
drop.
We can even. I mean, we go on that in a little bit, but I mean, the Danis and Paul. But I mean, that's an example too.
That's a circus.
It's a joke, man.
Yeah.
And then that's the only part where I would feel. It's just like, it's like, how can I compare? I'm trying to compare. You have morals. It's like that card that night was no morals.
Yeah. I didn't
there
watch.
Was no moral. At least like other like true boxing promoters, they have like, hey man, baseline, let's just be professional.
Yeah.
Now do whatever, you know, the commentating, whatever, but
I didn't watch it. But I think if anything, we saw that jumping guillotine's never a good idea in any combat sport.
Yeah.
From Dylan Danis' attempt. I didn't watch it, but I know it was a kind of a giant circus. There's the argument of that's kind of like a joke and it's ridiculous and why are they doing this? There's also the argument of like, hey, it's introducing fighting and boxing to a group of people who've never watched it before. Like, I don't know who watches the Paul brothers on YouTube. I had no idea who they were until they started started trying to fight, you know. But they bring with them a massive audience.
Oh, yeah.
And they might have a lot of carryover of people who might go from the Paul Brothers fans to fight fans.
Yeah.
But it's going to be some.
Yeah.
You know, there's going to be some there for sure. You know, and they are, I don't know what the undercard of this fight looked like, but I know there was at least one event they did in which they had, the undercard was a bunch of legit fighters.
Yeah, yeah, there was.
Fighters. You know, it's like, it's giving more people opportunity to fight, you know, and if anything, people who tuned in to an event like that, who watched one of the Paul Brothers box, Ben Askren or Tyron Woodley or whoever it is, if they watched anything before that and they had legit boxers there, they at least got a chance to see some real boxing.
Yeah.
You know? So I think it's half dozen one, six in the other. It's you can look at it kind of either way.
Yeah.
I personally don't enjoy it. I'm never going to spend money to watch a Logan or Jake Paul fight.
Yeah, I agree.
I'll definitely read about it afterwards and look at all the brawls that happen. You know?
Yeah, I mean, I'm more of the YouTube watcher after the fact on something like that. Now, if it's a card I want to watch, obviously I'm going to pay the money to watch it. And then I know I'm giving my money to something that I want to watch.
Yeah.
But then something like that, that's what I mean. But then that's the thing. Yeah. It's like, I agree. I think it definitely brings a lot of, like you're saying, a lot of people who don't watch.
Yeah.
And then they're like, oh, now I'm watching. And then now, next time. Yeah. When they do another, oh, I'm watching again, and they're paying the money, and they're keeping it going.
And I think the thing to remember is we're in the entertainment business,
mm-hmm.
which is why I talk about wanting to be entertained whenever I fight. We are only as valuable as we are, like, entertaining to people. We're only as valuable as we can sell tickets. So there is, I think that we, with MMA, you have a blend of two worlds. You have the martial arts world
mm-hmm.
and the prize fighting world.
Mm-hmm.
And those were separate. For mm-hmm. a long, long time. And now they're starting to verge together. And so at the end of the day, it's all about selling tickets and making money. It's entertainment. You mm-hmm. know, if you don't have a product that people want to see, then, you know, it doesn't matter. But the martial artists and all of us still loves the purity of the martial arts and the respect and the structure and the order and things like that. So I think that that's also why it makes it interesting too, all the personalities you see. And MMA and everything is a blend of the prize fighting world, which is boxing primarily in the US
mm-hmm.
and martial arts, mm-hmm. which is more structured. It's because now you have MMA gyms, right? Mm-hmm. MMA fighters and everything. But before it was karate, taekwondo, jiu-jitsu, wrestling.
Specifics.
It was a martial art, you know, so you're doing a martial art. And so we're kind of just, those two have now merged together and have gotten us MMA, which mm-hmm. is beautiful. But you end up with this kind of, like, sometimes you will look at it and you're like, oh, what is this? You know, like, kind of ridiculous side of it. But that's also a legitimate part of the sport too. You know, it's all about butts and seats at the end of the day.
Oh yeah. And then, I mean, that's why I mean, I'm glued to UFC and then one FC when I have a chance. And then, like I said, that last fight, that last Muay Thai, you knew the names. You just said
which one?
It was the
Rauteng.
Yeah,
Rauteng, when he fought, who did he fight?
He was lost. It Super Leg?
I think. Yeah, he lost.
He lost, but I thought. I mean, it looked like he was winning.
I think it was Super Leg, but it may not have been. It may have been somebody else. I think it was Super Leg.
But it was a lot, and it was nonstop.
It's a violent
back
fight.
Yeah, it was very violent fight. And it was just back and forth.
It was that fight was a big matter of size. Rauteng is a little undersized for the fight.
Yeah.
You know?
But I mean, but he was he was still handling his own, you know.
Yeah, no,
that's what I'm saying. Like he was still. I think he threw an elbow, or was he the one that received the elbow?
Oh, he sliced him up with elbows.
Yeah,
yeah, sliced him up nasty with elbows.
Yeah,
yeah.
So he did do that, as in getting back.
Yeah,
yeah, I remember that. Yeah, because I was like,
yeah, I think ooh. I can't remember the way it played. I know, like, he got dropped in one round, so he lost that round, and then there's another round that I think he just got kind of bullied around a little bit. I remember watching it and agreeing with the decision.
Yeah.
But I know it was a phenomenal fight.
Well, I mean, I'll be honest. You probably watched it from beginning. I was watching, like, rounds. But what caught me was just that elbow.
Yeah.
And then I always feel like
when you get an elbow like that, like you're just,
yeah.
I mean, you've gotten more than rocked. I mean, now your head's opened up and now you're bleeding. Yeah. And then, I mean, you got that on your mind now. And then,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's,
things you got to look at the whole round as a whole, the whole picture, right? You know, a lot can happen in a round, you know? So that elbow may be like a highlight from the round because it gashed him wide open, had blow over his face. But what happened before and after, you know, like it's a whole lot goes into it.
Oof.
You know? Yeah. Also, Muay Thai is judged a little differently. Like Muay Thai scored a little differently than we're used to. And that took place in Thailand, I believe.
Yeah.
And they're going to judge it differently.
Oh, yeah.
Depending on where you're at and who your judges are in the sport, like they're going to judge a little bit differently. Just due to a number of factors.
But even that fight, for example, that's what I'm saying. Like that fight, I think, is a perfect example of why there could be more fights like that. And then I'm not saying there's not here in the U.S., but I'm just saying televised like that, like more commercialized. Yeah. Because I mean, they don't because I feel people be like, oh damn, and then you catch people then watching like. Damn, I'm gonna watch that. When's it come out? Oh, wait, hey, and then next thing you know, they're like tuning in and they're watching it. Next thing you know, you got a crowd. Next thing you know, hey, we got a lot of people coming from America. You know what? Let's do a show there. And boom.
ONE FC's starting to do it. They're starting to do shows here in the U.S.
Yeah,
which I'm pumped about. I think it's super, super cool. It's good. More fighting is always good.
Yeah,
right. It's always a good thing. Do you want to talk about the fight this weekend?
Definitely. I have questions. Yeah.
What do you think? Okay. So, just off the bat.
Yeah.
Usman or Chimaev?
Chimaev.
And then Volkanovski or Makhachev?
Volk.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I disagree with you on both of those. We're going to talk about why. So, you pick Chimaev or Usman. Why?
The reason I picked Chimaev is like you were saying earlier, he goes in. He he's going to go like a damn...
super aggressive.
Yeah, he's going to just go in there aggressive and just rock him. But yet again, he's going to get tired out. I know that. On the other end, just that little spill of them hearing that maybe Usman's knees are messed up. I don't know how that true is.
But that's been known for years.
Yeah, he's always
his
had...
knees have been blown for years. He talks about on the Rogan podcast years ago, he can't run because his knees are shot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I know... And then... Not saying I agree with Chimaev because I know Chimaev's like, I just know he's very aggressive, but then he kind of plays this bad dude man in there, man.
He's an asshole.
And that's what I'm saying. And that's the only thing. Yeah. And I'm not saying I agree for an asshole to win.
We're just talking about the fight.
But in general, what I would say, like Chimaev just is going to be very aggressive, and I don't know if Usman can handle that.
Okay.
And then when it goes to Volk.
We'll get to that in a second.
Okay.
Let's talk about this first.
Okay.
So this is my spiel.
No,
so
I'm down.
I've been saying this all week, and it's now on record, officially on recording. So if anyone wants to talk to me afterwards, they can, if I'm wrong.
No, I'm down.
So you're right. So Chimaev is incredibly aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
But he's a great wrestler. But we saw him when he fought Burns.
Oh, yeah.
I felt that Burns did a pretty good job of countering his wrestling and at least made him work really hard for it. We basically kind of abandoned wrestling and just started getting in a brawl with Burns, which is the fight Burns would want.
Yeah.
I feel Usman is a much better wrestler than Burns is. So I feel like if Usman can weather that storm that's going to come out right away, because Chimaev's done it in every single fight. He comes out and goes right away. I think that's going to be to his detriment against Usman, because Usman has so much experience. His average fight time is like 17 minutes. His average fight time is longer than a full 3-round fight.
Yeah.
Which is, that's a lot of fight time. Yeah, he's got a lot. So, you know, he has been a lot of time fighting at the highest level.
Yeah.
If he can weather that storm of that initial barrage of whatever Chimaev throws at him and let him slow down, I feel like he's going to be able to nullify his wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
And where the difference between Usman and Burns is a very like heavy-handed big punches. Not a brawler, but he's not gonna throw super crisp 1-2s down the pipe,
mm-hmm.
right? Usman does. Mm-hmm. Usman has developed a great jab.
Oh yeah,
and he's a really good 1-2.
Yeah,
and if he can stay small and low, and if he can stay inside, they said that after Chimaev fought Burns that he was fighting dumb and he can fight much better than that. We haven't seen that yet. We haven't seen him fight because all of his fights are over like that. We haven't seen mm-hmm. him strike. But if that's the level of striking that he's capable of, I think Usman picks him apart in the feet. So I think, I'm going to put it out there on the record, I think Usman's going to beat him by decision. Yeah. I think he's going to pick him apart in the feet, basically, and counter his wrestling. You know, and I think we're going to see Chimaev fade. We haven't seen Chimaev really go very long in a fight, yeah. except for Burns, and he did slow down. You know, so that is the, I think the experience, mm-hmm. and also Usman's not cutting weight. Usman's a thick dude.
No, he's a big dude. Yeah.
He's not going to be cutting much weight going to 85. He's going to cut weight, but not like he was a 70. You know, I'm sure he's probably still in good shape. I'm sure he stays in the training room. He seems like the kind of guy who's going to stay busy and stay active.
Yeah.
Making assumptions. I don't know him. But so I feel he's going to have at least some decent level of cardio. I think Chimaev's going to slow down. And I think that Usman's going to be able to pick him apart. You know, that's my 2 cents.
Because, see, they're already lining up that if Chimaev does win, then he has to go against Strickland afterwards.
Well, they said that whoever wins this fight gets title shot next.
Yeah.
Gets title shot next.
So, it's going to be a good fight, though. Yeah. It's definitely going to be a good fight.
Yeah.
And then I'm definitely going to have this one posted. So, I'm definitely
have this one posted. I was going to ask, when is...
Yeah, No. I'm going to post this one. I'm posting this one before Saturday. Well, okay, Friday, cool. Tomorrow, yeah. So today, so I'm pushing it. Yeah, yeah.
So everyone can... Yeah, can
I'm pushing it through.
Everyone can message me and can talk shit to me. Or you can just like clip this part out and post it if you want. But everyone can talk shit if I'm wrong. But that's my 2 cents. So I have more things we're going to talk about. I have more questions.
Well, no. But I wanted to go back. So I saw the Burns and Chimaev. And I... yeah, man. Burns, I don't know, bro. That's when I had really saw him fight, and man, that dude, like, I mean, all I know, he's a tough cat, man.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, but see, that was like another, I'm bouncing off what you said earlier, but like he came to dance, man. That boy came to like, that's what I'm saying. I think, I mean, cause to be honest, I thought it was almost even, man. I mean, it was like, even down to the end because I felt that's a perfect example of just like what we had started the podcast off of was just like saying that like that guy came with everything and like already ready. Burns came ready and Chimaev came ready.
Yeah.
And then boom, then that's the product you got. Mm-hmm. You got definitely like two guys that were ready.
Yeah.
And then that's what you got, you know. And I feel like, say, if Burns maybe was not in the right mind or something, maybe he would have won. Maybe he would have lost.
Yeah.
Or maybe if Chimaev was maybe in somewhere that he shouldn't have been mentally, then maybe Burns would have knocked his ass. I don't know. But that was, like, a perfect fight. And I really haven't – I've seen here and there maybe Tyson Fury. I mean, that's boxing. But I'm just saying, like, where it's all in like that, man. Just, like, where it was just – so that – and then that's why I'm saying, like, with Chimaev, that's why I just feel like I just hope Usman is ready because I just know Chimaev. Well, and then I know Usman ain't stupid, like you said.
Yeah.
He is definitely experienced. He definitely knows. He's been there before.
Yeah.
Yeah, he doesn't go. I mean, Usman is definitely, he's entertaining, man. And then definitely he ain't going to go. I know he ain't going to, he's not going home easily. I know that much.
No, I think he's gonna fight smart. I feel like he's gonna be a fighter smarter than Chimaev's gonna be. You know, but we'll see. We'll see Saturday. You picked Volk.
Yeah.
Over Makhachev. Why?
I picked Volk because I. It's just Islam is just. I feel I'm not gonna say he rides on Khabib's tail. Mm-hmm. But a lot of people have reference to Khabib and him.
Yeah.
And then that's part I don't like because I feel he's a totally different fighter. You might see Khabib in the corner. Fighter. You might see him, but he's a totally different fighter from Khabib.
Mm-hmm.
So I hate that. I hate that association. So that's one thing I hate. So I feel like they kind of,
in a way, they kind of put him on a higher pedestal because of that, which I feel he's a totally different fighter from Khabib.
Yeah. Do you think he's not the same level as Khabib? Is that what you're getting at?
No, the dude's strong, man.
Yeah.
That dude is, he's very.
Why do you think Volk wins the fight? Why is your, is it
because he's on it? No, because that's what I feel. I when I go to Volk, Volk's just Volk. Volk's always just been Volk.
Yeah.
Volk shows up, Volk is there. That's a tough, I hate to say he's short, but that's a tough, short dude, man.
Yeah.
I would be like, I feel a 6'2" guy should be scared of Volk, man.
Yeah.
That dude is like it's like a tumbler, man.
Yeah.
It's like a tumbler that just like do this, he's do that, going. And then tumbling, tumble back. I mean, you just see him, man. He's just like a rock.
Yeah.
So I feel like he's not, and that's what I like about him. And that's why I would say Volk.
Yeah. You have a feeling that Volk's going to do it. I don't have as much of like a analytical perspective on this one as the last one. But I think when you consider Makhachev was prepared to get in there with a better grappler than Volk, more threatening grappler than Volk. You know, Oliveira's phenomenal submission artist. You know, getting ready for that. I think that Volk relies real heavy on his cardio. And he rode real heavy on the cardio in the first fight.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure he's going to be in shape in some level, but he's not going to be in the same shape that he was the first time. You're not going to be in shape. You know, you get ready for a full camp versus a 10-day notice, whatever it is. It's just a different thing.
Yeah.
I feel like I think that Makhachev's grappling is going to be a little more effective this time around than it was the first, you know, because even like everyone kind of, and I'm a massive Volkanovski fan.
Yeah.
He is one of my top, like massive Volkanovski fan. But if you go back and watch the fight just for what it is, even the times where Volk is like, he's smiling and like doing thumbs up, stuff like that, he still loses the fight. He's got a backpack on that's trying to strangle him the whole time. Like he's still losing the fight when he's there, you know? So I just don't see him coming off of the couch basically on 2 weeks' notice and being able to do more than he did the first time. I may be totally wrong, and if I lose, DM me.
I would even take your advice from the other thing on like the Usman to him, which I know the two different fighters, but like what you said, like, you know, we don't know what Volk's been really doing. I don't know. I mean, I was kind of disappointed with Oliveira, man. And, I mean, actually, Costas, I thought that was going to happen, but it didn't happen.
What? That's so weird. He had surgery on his elbow
He caught a staph infection on his elbow.
Oh.
And so they cut into it.
Okay.
And to get rid of the infection, and the infection's still there.
Yeah.
So man, that I can see, yeah. And then, of course, Oliveira, they're saying, you know, I don't know. I
mean, well, you saw the cut, right?
Yeah, I saw the cut.
Massive headbutt, apparently.
Yeah, and then they were blaming the training partners. Like, who's he training with? And then they were saying that too. And then they were also saying that he had already said that he didn't want to be fighting over in Abu Dhabi because of the fact that he felt that was like kind of
enemy territory.
Yeah, like, whatever. Yeah. And I mean, I think that's just bad juju.
Oliver is a killer. I don't think that he was trying to get out of a fight because he didn't want to fight in that guy's hometown, or not hometown, but that area, you know. The thing is like, at one hand, why are you have to be smart training, right? Why are you doing that? How does that happen week for a fight? But shit also happens. Accidents happen.
Yeah.
You know, I've had them happen before. I've gotten cut before fights, and you know, it sucks. It's a really frustrating aspect of the sport, but sometimes that shit does happen. I just wanted to see the fight. I was just really excited to see the fight.
No, and that's what I was. I was just ready to see Oliveira like try to, you know, do his thing, and that didn't happen. So
I'm an Oliveira fan as well. Did you? I'm sure you watched Strickland versus Adesanya.
Oh yeah.
You mentioned it earlier.
Yeah.
That was impressive.
Yeah, that was because earlier I had watched him and Alex. I had watched Sean and Alex the previous. I don't know. Maybe it was like a year ago, and then and Strickland had the same thing.
He did the same thing.
And what tripped me about that is that, like, it's scary because, I mean, I don't know. I just always know Coach G used to tell me, you know.
Yeah.
Especially so, you're that close, hands up. He got rocked and knocked out.
The thing is like, you know, the weird unorthodox guy mm-hmm. is the guy that gives the elite guy problems.
Wow.
Like, that's the guy like you'll see like the really, really good technical guy mm-hmm. against other technical people is going to do well.
Mm-hmm.
And then you throw someone who is not just does things weird and that can really throw somebody off. And so much of Izzy's game is based off of his jab.
Yeah.
And his low kicks.
Yeah.
And because of Sean's weird defensive style, he couldn't get his jab going. He couldn't get anything going. He couldn't get his
big
kicks going. He's a big dude too.
Yeah.
He couldn't get going, and so it was just like a train going down, like a snowball going downhill. Like Sean just kept pressuring, and he basically threw a 1-2,
mm-hmm.
and a long hook. And a couple goofy kicks sometimes. That was basically the fight. Like, he basically threw a 1-2 and a jab and touched him and just avoided getting cracked with anything significant enough to kind of turn the tide of the fight, you know? It was a very interesting fight to watch as a viewer, you know, watching Izzy struggle with that.
But see, even and then see what I tripped out too, even when I was saying about that, when Sean Strickland fought Alex. Alex is bigger than Sean.
Alex Mejia is huge.
He's a huge dude. So then it was like Alex, Sean, and then I felt Sean and Asanya were like kind of like, I mean, they're weight wise, but like I said, I just see that. I mean, I'll say, man, he's a big white boy, man. That boy,
he's a
big tough white boy, and boy got a chin on his. I mean, he has a chin too. He could take some hits.
Yeah,
and so I know that when I did see him get knocked out. I mean, yeah, he's always been ready. It's just like you said. I mean, like I'm saying, like he's come out of his shell, like you're saying.
Yeah.
His Asanya's
just. He's got a weird style.
Asanya just did not. And then that's where I'm piggyback again, like saying what you're saying earlier. I don't think Israel was all there, man. I don't think he was there mentally. It wasn't like they were saying, like.
Yeah.
Just wasn't himself, and like who knows what's going on in his life, and I just know he has a lot of potential. But then also all those fights before that he did within 14 months, they say.
I mean that weighs a toll for sure. And like Izzy may have been flat or maybe been a little off, or Sean just may have been that weird and just couldn't get out of whatever rut he was in the moment, you know. But it's definitely I would never encourage anybody to fight like Sean Strickland does, but he does it really well.
That's what trips me out. It trips really me well. Out because I'm just like, wow, man. And then I mean, dude, even watching towards the end of that fight, like he was yelling at him.
he
wanted him. He was like, yo, come, like what else you got? And then you literally saw within those seconds that Israel was nothing. He couldn't come up with anything else. Like you were saying, he was out of his plans. Like what else am I supposed to do?
The thing that surprised me is Izzy didn't try and grapple at all.
See that?
That was kind of strange to me. Like he didn't, he never tried to, but he hasn't had to ever, you know, he's never had to.
Yeah.
But I just was surprised me. He never tried to, he never attempted to. And we don't know, like, who knows how much he grapples in sparring or how if he's taking shots in sparring rounds or how much he grapples in the gym. Like, you know, he obviously has got really good defense.
Yeah.
You know, and just been able to use his striking to beat everybody. But it was kind of surprising me that we didn't see him at least attempt to do some kind of tie-up, take a shot, grapple, anything.
And you know, of course, and then that shit, you know, kind of sucked that he got his DWI or whatever. We found that out, you know, and... Did you ever hear about that?
I didn't. No.
Really?
Didn't,
yeah, he got a DWI. I believe it was wherever he lives at.
New Zealand.
Yeah. And it came out like a few weeks after that. But even when that came out, like, I mean, you could I resonate with that because I've had one myself, and that ain't cool, and I don't wish that on anybody. So I mean, me just having that experience is like, maybe that guy just wasn't in his right mind, like you were saying, you know, maybe. like from what we said from the very beginning, you have to show up,
yeah,
and you have to be mentally ready, yeah. And that's why I love about fighting. I love watching fights, because I just give so much respect. Because like I said, it's almost like, you know, of course, I wish I would have stayed in the military now a little bit longer, just saying, because I just love that kind of discipline. Of course, it gets old when you get deployments and it gets sucks when you're away from family. But then again, like, it's very relative to things that people love to do. And like you said, you love to fight, and sometimes you got to turn that phone off. Sometimes you got to, like you said, you got to put in your 6 days a week. So then, you know, a lot of things that I always kind of wish I would have opened my eyes a little bit younger was, like Kobe Bryant, you know,
mm-hmm.
like, Allen Iverson was always, I think they would like take jabs or whatever, but you know, I guess Allen Iverson was going out to the clubs, you know, they're already in the NBA
partying. Yeah.
And, you know, I guess he took it as far, he would still show up and be a good basketball player the next day, but I guess Kobe just had a mindset of just saying, no, I'm being more focused. Instead of doing that, I'm gonna go play. Because it's almost I do that with my own self, but it's like I feel like you put in the time, the hours, and you got X amount of hours. The more hours, the better.
Yeah.
If you don't put X amount of hours in, of course you're gonna have the result you have.
Yeah.
And I mean. I can go all over with that one, because I feel like some athletes, I have to say it, some athletes do work better under pressure, and some athletes do work better when they're very limited or very, and then you have some athletes that succeed where maybe they, you know, whatever, but then you have these other athletes where they succeed naturally because, you know, they're doing everything they're supposed to.
Some athletes, if they get too, especially fighters, because fighters, like, they're different type of people usually. If they get too structured and too roped in, then they don't do as well.
Yeah.
You know, it kind of, there are those guys who do better when they just take things casually and just go fight and have fun versus try and do everything, you know, stay regimented, stay disciplined. And, you know, sometimes, like I said, different strokes, different folks. Everyone kind of has their own little way they got to kind of find of doing it. You know, there's a lot of right ways to do it. It's more than one way to skin a cat.
Yeah.
You know, there's some wrong ways to do it, but there's more than one right way to do it.
Yeah.
You know, so like the way I operate before fights and during camps and outside of camps and stuff is going to be different than somebody else.
Yeah.
You know, you just got to find whatever works, wherever works for you to have the most success you possibly have, you know.
But I mean, and that's what I said. I just respect any athlete. I mean, in any sport, you know, you have to put the time in to put it in.
Mm-hmm.
And when it goes from there, you know, of course, you're going to get your result. If you get your result, you get your result.
Yeah.
Did you want to watch, did you want to catch one, or did you see if we catch the fight? Or, I mean, I guess one of yours, or?
If you want to, we can. Yeah. I'm totally up for whatever.
And then,
I know, like I said, my first Fury fight is on YouTube. It only lasted like a minute. And then the last one's on Fight Pass.
No, so yeah, we're already, you know, we've been going for a minute.
Oh yeah, we have been.
Should I look it up? Clear Channel or?
Yeah, if you're going to look at my first fight. Yeah, you can go to Clear Channel and type in, I think it's Clear Channel. Or it's Clear Life maybe? Clear Life.
Oh Media. Yeah, Clear Life, that's right.
Yeah, I think it's Clear Life Media.
Yeah, I've met those guys. Shout out to those dudes. Those dudes are doing good things too. And then FC, I believe the president now has his own podcast now. The president of FC, Fury. FC. I'm sorry, Fury. I'm missing Fury.
Yeah. They have the Fury Unleashed podcast. Yeah. If you maybe like Clear Life, and then like just Google like Jacob Berry versus Juan.
I would love to have that dude on. That would be awesome. Clear Life Media, right?
Yeah, Clear Life Media. And you may want to put my name there too if it'll...
Oh, yeah. I need a Jamie, man. I need a...
You need someone on the keyboard to get it pulled up.
For Jacob or...
Yeah. Maybe put my name and then see if that, maybe MMA, see if that, that pulls it up. Maybe getting way too specific. I don't know.
No, I should.
Let's see what it says. There we go. Second one.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. We can probably fast forward to the actual fight. So this fight.
Right there, huh?
You can keep going. I have to walk out still. Oh.
So who's this dude?
So Juan Pena, so I was having a hard time. This is my debut. And I was having, and part of the reason I went pro when I did is because it was kind of hard to find guys to fight, just because of all the Muay Thai experience and stuff like that. And I think that, you know, it just was tougher to find fights. So I fought, I actually hit up, Colin Wright was doing the matchmaking for the show.
Oh, wow.
And I actually hit up Colin and said, hey, message this guy, because he was just having a hard time finding guys to find. I think at the time, Juan's like, he's like 2-7, but he's got 9 fights.
Yeah.
You know, and it's 9 MMA fights. He's got like, and he's done bare knuckle and Muay Thai and stuff like that. He's been around for a long time.
Right.
Yeah, this is the, one of the few fights in which I've had a full camp with the same opponent and, got to prepare for him. He's a stocky dude. He kind of throws big punches.
And what this is 145?
This is 155.
Oh, 155.
Yeah, this is back at 55. You can see there, like, I'm a little soft in the midsection for this weight class.
Yeah.
So
what's going through your head right now? You're just like...
Just in the moment. I'm just kind of there, you know?
He's a little older, too.
Yeah, older. He's been doing it for a minute. He's got a lot of bare knuckle fights. He has some Muay Thai fights and stuff like that, too.
So Colin found this guy.
No, I found him.
So you told Colin
to message this guy. Yeah.
And then he responded.
Yeah. And he took the fight. Yeah. He took the fight. And
so I was trying to do that, but so then you had called this guy.
I hadn't called him. No, okay. No, Colin did. Yeah. I just looked on Tapology looking for guys.
Yeah.
And I just, and saw he was recently, he's fighting actively, like he recently fought like 2 months ago before this fight. I saw that he was being active and I figured he might be down to fight, so that's why I hit up Colin to, hey, call this guy. So we kind of picked him. But southpaw, thick dude, he's strong. You'll see that he doesn't really engage in the striking. Like he kind of, I think his game plan, and afterwards, he kind of mentioned it to coach. He thought I just knew Muay Thai and that was it. His game plan was, I think, to take me down and grapple. And you'll see that he engages. He kind of grabs me pretty quick.
So at this point, I guess he doesn't know. I mean, he's very limited knowing about you, or?
Yeah, we don't know much about each other. Yeah. I don't know much about him. He doesn't know much about me, which is most fights.
You don't know
all that much. At this point, it's kind of routine to fight. So I'm kind of just calm, relaxed. I experience a lot of anxiety on fight day, right before the fight.
Yeah.
Especially like as I'm warming up. And then it kind of peaks before I walk. And then once I make the walk and get cage side, it kind of dissipates. It kind of goes away. And you're kind of just in the moment. You're kind of just reacting to things.
Ooh. Yeah. Left kick. Right kick.
Yeah. Definitely moving him around, making him move around, huh?
Yeah. And then right here, he
that's when he's like, oh, let me see if I can get him down.
Yeah. He was very, very strong.
Do you prefer to do the MMA in the ring, though?
You know, the funny thing is I fought so much in a ring that it was really, really comfortable.
Yeah.
You know, like it is kind of weird to think because you're so used to the cage in MMA.
Yeah.
But I mean, you just use the corner post. But like I said, you know, a lot of my Muay Thai fights, I was a kicker and a clincher. And so I won a lot of fights right here.
Right.
I put guys against the corner post and beat them up with knees and elbows and throws from there.
Nice.
And of course, being MMA, we just follow him down to the ground. Now, this is when I realized he didn't really know how to get up from here. Because what he should have been trying to do is swim his elbow in, get to his left hip, and trying to get his knees in between himself and me and right. try and get space, right?
So like flip
and
around?
Yeah, and he held on to my head and tried to like roll me over or hold me down.
So right now you can elbow him right in the forehead if you wanted to, right? Yep, well, you are doing it. Yeah, that's what you're doing.
Yeah,
right?
It's a lot of elbows from here. Yeah.
Boom. Oh yeah. Yeah, you're definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, I would say you've already won this round.
Oh, it doesn't last much longer than this. It stops really quick. Professor Solis goes around. He stops it right here, I think.
I mean, at this point, yeah.
Oh, yeah, he okay. called it from there.
Did the opponent, he agree? Did Pena agree? Or
Yeah, he was cool. That's the thing is, like, you know, we talked about, and that's the fight, but we talked about, like, different fighters' mentalities and stuff like that. Like, mm-hmm. I'm cool with everyone I fight. Like, I have no reason to have any.
No,
and
definitely.
Everyone I fought up to this point has basically been the same. Like, him, the guy I fought in Dallas, my second fight, I can't remember his name now. The guy I fought my first Yuri fight, the last guy. They're all, you know, professionals. Shake my hand. What's up? We're going to fight each other. It is what it is. You know, and Juan, same thing. He was very, very, you know, respectful and cordial before and afterwards and stuff like that. So,
and then you got a purse that day, money purse.
Yeah, this was my pro debut. First time I got paid.
Yeah.
First time I got paid to fight was this one.
So now you're in the professional world, pretty much.
Yeah, and I've got 4 professional fights now.
So does that? Of course, you've already registered and all that. So now your card is alive. Now you actually have a record.
Yeah, my record.
I mean, documented and everything. I mean, now it's documented. Now, like you said, you got to consider, be ready. Like you said, you're already planning next year to hit it hard and go forth with it.
Yeah.
Awesome, man.
Now is whenever it all matters, you know?
Yeah.
So,
is there another one? Oh, there's, I know that dude.
Oh yeah. Those are the other, some other Clear Life does a good job. They do a lot of the pay-per-views and streaming and stuff. They did it for, the Muay Thai fights last weekend.
Oh,
they do a lot of the production stuff.
So I know recently the only thing I knew about was the IKF.
Yeah. The kickboxing.
Yeah. So going back to what you were saying. So there's the Texas
Muay Thai Championships.
Muay Thai Championships.
Mm-hmm.
That's one promotion company, right? And
it's, that's they're a Muay Thai promotion.
Promotion. Yeah, and then we also have the IKF, right?
So IKF is a big like a national. IKF, I think, stands for International Kickboxing Federation.
But that's like, of course, that's for, I know, beginners, amateurs, just trying to get in with pads and all that.
A lot of it's like, I think they do have IKF sanctioned tournaments, like actual fights. But a lot of the IKF stuff you see, I've never been to an IKF event. But I believe it's a lot like point sparring kind of stuff. It's for like, you know, development and things like that.
Well, not because I went to a few and I recorded a few, just taking pictures and stuff. And that was IKF. But I never really understood it because I was like, is there another branch that maybe goes into the something like, but like I said, I still would love to see it because you see some crazy things there too. But I definitely would like to check out the Texas Muay Thai
Championships. Yeah. I'm not. I think they're going to do another one in January, maybe.
Yeah.
It's a great. I've been fortunate enough to commentate the last 3, the pay per view. Commentate the pay per view with Kru Bob, and it is a fantastic experience. It's a great show.
Yeah.
You hear about fun fights. The fights are always fun to watch. You're really getting to see growth in the Texas Muay Thai, but also just like just the amateur fighters that are coming up through the promotion. They've had, I think this was their 6th event they've put on. Really good product, really fun to watch, great people to work with. It's really given local Muay Thai fighters, especially amateurs, an opportunity to actually.
Yeah, because I want to support more. I do want to support more. I mean, that's my plan, is to show up to more Muay Thai events and support that. No, I'm down with Fury. Like you said, I'm a fight nerd too. Anything dealing with fighting, I'm there. I'm boxing, anything, karate, I don't care. But overall, like, I still have a heart for, because, you know, like I said, Coach G got me into it.
Muay Thai is my first love.
Muay Thai, man. Yeah. Like I said, waking up on a Saturday, knocking out a nice hour workout.
Yeah.
And then you got the rest of the day and just relax, whatever. I love that.
I definitely encourage you, man, next time. And like I always post about, Kru Bob posts about the events when they come up, is the Texas Muay Thai Championship shows. They're great opportunity, great shows, great productions, a lot of fun. So that's the best, like, the best we've seen as far as like the opportunities for amateur Muay Thai fighters coming up in the region.
And then the other idea that I plan on doing too is that I'm getting some other things done for the productions where I want to go to the gyms. So that would be a little bit more where, like I said, because that's also, I mean, nothing against some other fighters. I've had other fighters that have been wanting to come, but you know, considering their schedule, their training.
Yeah.
And then that's why I always say at the very end of my test, I know you're busy.
Yeah.
Because it takes a lot. It takes a lot for you to take time out of your schedule to do, you know, just an interview.
I'm really fortunate that like all my life revolves around gym and fighting and stuff like that. Like I work at the gym, I train at the gym, I fight, I do privates out of the gym. You know, I have some other stuff I do on the side as well, but you know, my schedule is usually pretty flexible because of that, you know, like midday I can come out here.
Well, dude, you got a home here, bro. Like I said, definitely. The other idea that's always been thrown out was to have a few mics and then have the fight over there. And then we just sit here and just
sit there and talk about the fight.
And just talk about the fight and just record and just document. Yeah. And then there, that's going to take a little bit more production because then I got to have all that ready, make sure everything's working right. And then, because I mean, considering I don't know how many fights we go over, but the test subject I wanted to do was like probably the first top two UFC fight, like you know the ending of the two UFC fights. So it'd be like the main, you know.
The main and co-main event.
Yeah,
test it out. Supposed to do a whole event that's 3 hours.
Oh, yeah,
long.
Man. I can't. Yeah. I mean, because out of those, that probably might be maybe have a little podcast after and just shoot the shit and talk about it, whatever, you know.
Yeah.
From there. So lot of ideas going through my head, you know. But definitely, I definitely want to make it to the gym to, for one, train and also interview. So that'll be the future.
Yeah.
You know, because I know I can go portable. And then just get the interview, you know, get it right there.
Some of the guys fighting afterwards.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. You can get it right there, you know. Well, there I believe it goes into, because I know some certain promotions, they only, you know, Clear Life has certain things. So then it kind of gets hairy there. Me, I'll be more like going to the day of their training.
Interviewing after training.
Yeah, and
then
interview on my own. Interview on my own because I don't want to cross any.
No, I know what you mean. But like after the fighters train, like talk to him after the train.
Yeah, because a lot of people already claim, oh, hey, man, we're Clear Live. We got this or that. I don't know how it works. I just know, you know, everybody, like ESPN, a friend of mine said that they were doing basketball or football and they showed up and they were about to go live and they went. And then the ESPN, somebody came up to him and said, hey, you got to turn that off.
Yeah.
Like there was actually somebody there who was actually or monitoring, like if anybody was doing any type of side broadcast.
There's a lot of like copyrights and stuff like that. I know that I think that Eric and the guys from Fury, Eric Burmaster and Leggett, and then they did a podcast during a PCS show. I think.
Oh yeah, yeah.
I think they did a podcast during, like live at the PCS event, the Paradigm Combat Sports Card, the last PCS show they had.
Yeah, the Paradigm throws great shows. Like I don't know if they have another one coming up. I'm not sure.
I don't know. I mean, that was their first one.
First one, yeah.
Yeah, their first one was that one I was on. Yeah.
You know what? To speak of it, I don't think I I DJ'd. Whatever. We'll go off of that one. I might cut off of that. I might edit that out real quick. Yeah. But anyways. But nah, dude, did you want to watch that last one? Is that other one on there? If not, we can't.
I mean, it's only, yeah, we can. It's a minute long. If you want to watch the Fury fight, it's on, if you Google, you probably put my name in there or put my name in Fury. Just get rid of the Clear Life part.
I got to go back.
Probably check that one on. Canales. Ricardo Canales was his name. If you look up Jacob Bray versus Ricardo Canales or whatever. How many podcast episodes have you done thus far?
This might be 26 or 27.
Oh, wow. So you did a bunch of them.
Yeah. I don't know. Nah, I'm going by...
E, with an E.
Oh, man. I'm sorry, dude.
Oh, you're good. I just don't want to pull up the wrong thing.
No, so the whole learning from what I've learned from other podcasters that, yeah, you don't break it until you...
That's it
right there.
Yeah.
After, it's like a video game. but I was saying like 100 episodes apparently. And then because, I mean, I learn a little bit every time. Like I go back and I listen. I was like, man, I should ask this or I should ask that.
Yeah.
Or then we should have started this way or that way. But then, you know, it's always, like I said, it's always just goes from there. Yeah. And then you just learn every time you do
so
one.
So I say 100 episodes is basically after that you start figuring it out, essentially?
I'm going by that Mr. Beast, which is the king of YouTube. Mr. Beast is like one of the guys that first YouTubers. And he says that, yeah, your first 100, first whatever, they are what they are. They could be good quality. They could have good material and all that. But he goes, you just learn so much.
You're after still finding the product at that
point. Yeah, you're still searching, and you'll eventually might get to that point where then you're like, boom, that's it. And then you roll with it.
Yeah.
So then that's the whole other idea. Because then again, you know, my whole key to this is just to show Houston fighters, Houston everything, Houston.
Yeah.
You know, until I move to Austin, which I know ain't going to happen anytime soon, but... That'll be the whole goal eventually to move to Austin.
Yeah.
But I plan on going more to, I plan on hopefully going to South by Southwest and promoting more of the podcast then.
Yeah.
Doing more stand up so I can get out there and then just pop and stay in the gym, you know?
Yeah.
And then live a life, man. But, you know, easier said than done, you know?
Yeah. I've always found podcasting fascinating. I've always thought it'd be fun to do like fight podcasts because I love talking about fights.
No, yeah. Well, see, when I was younger, I used to get in a lot of little fights and, you know, at home, around the neighborhood. And then when I got to high school, I was a skinny man. I was like 6'5", 10, 5, 11. Close to my same height. And I was like stick, man. But I was in cross country. And then I got a lot of stupid trouble and then stupid things after that. And then so I really wish I would have gotten involved more into this when I was a lot younger. It probably would have helped me out a little bit better, you know?
Yeah.
to keep, I wouldn't have wasted so much time, you know?
Yeah.
It's the whole key is just... So who's this guy?
So this is Ricardo Canales. He fights out of Jackson Wake. He actually fights this weekend. He's actually fighting Oliver Jimenez this weekend on the Fury card. On the Fury Challenger Series card. He's another guy I didn't know a whole lot about him. He was like undefeated as an amateur, and it said his record's 1-2. He wasn't 1-2. He was 0-1.
Yeah.
Coming into this fight, he fought on some like Road to 1FC event or something like that.
Yeah.
And got clipped in that fight. Like I said, he was 3-0 as an amateur. Older guy, and you'll see. I'm a little more patient this time. In this one, this is also the fight right after I had just lost by getting too aggressive.
Right. That and was so the one you were talking
this,
about earlier.
I feel like after that loss, when I kind of started to find myself in the cage, I started to kind of find how I operate best, you know, because also I'm not used to 5-minute rounds.
Yeah.
You know, because Muay Thai are short rounds, amateurs are short rounds. It's back when before I cut my hair.
So the whole idea is just to represent Houston I've this general area I'm from, so that's where, you know, of course here the studio, and then to see where it goes, and then and like I said, all my experience from the military, living overseas, I try to bring all that too. And then of course, I do some other volunteer work for some things for homeless people. So I do that. Cool, and man, see, that's another thing. It's so weird because I see some young kids come in. And, dude, you see these big kids, this and that. And I tell them, I say, hey, bro, you ever thought about amateur fighting?
Trying to spread it to other people.
Like, hey,
but that's what happens, though. Is once you start doing it, you want everyone else to do it, too. You're like, hey, this is so cool, you should do it, too.
And well, I mean, because I see a guy with more weight than me, taller than me, a long reach, and I'm like, wow, you know? I'm like, yo, man, you probably want to take advantage of that that height that you got and that reach. So you're bouncing around, getting around him, right? He's not really, he's just kind of going here and there. I don't know about that kick.
Yeah, he wasn't in a big rush. He's another guy who's patient.
Ooh, ooh, bro, you already rocked him, bro.
Yeah, the fight, I think, is 1:10. Because I catch him with the right hand, sit him down, and this is, you can tell the difference between like Juan, who, in all much respect and love to Juan, he's a nice guy. You know, right away he was trying to get his legs in front of me and trying to get space. You can tell he's more savvy on the ground. So I gotta give a quick shout out to Cody Freeman.
Yeah.
Cody worked this with me in before the fight, a few months before, but that arm trap there. And it's something I've always been familiar with, but never really had somebody technically explain it to me about letting them posture up on that elbow and then reaching over and grabbing the forearm and then pushing them forward, right? So if you, I don't know if you have a way to rewind it.
So wait. So you're saying...
So if you can go back there, that's fine.
Yeah, right there, right?
Yeah, that's good. So Cody Freeman, Kru Bob and Cody are my
so he has you,
corners. Yeah. So if you look when he turns, I'll give him space. My right arm goes under his body and I'll have him posture up. See, I'm gonna isolate the arm. He'll posture up and I grab it with my right arm under his back.
Oh wow.
And then drive him over. So you what pins him there.
So you get in position.
Yeah, so he's stuck at that point.
Wow.
So I got a quick turn to Cody Freeman.
That's a nice move, bro.
he had us drill that one of his. He teaches a cage work class at the gym 3 times a week. Great class. It's just cage work.
That's awesome.
And that's one of the things he went over in that class. And it.
Because, yeah, you worked. Had him like this, and then you just took advantage.
Real simple.
And then you had that just still planted, and then he was kind of just, he had nowhere to move at all.
Yeah, he had nowhere to go. You know, just simple fundamentals. And that, you know, that's why I like, you know, I go back and watch fights. That's something I try and take pride in is like, because I'm always preaching fundamentals to like the guys that I teach and our amateurs and Kru Bob's always having us drill and teach fundamentals and things like that is seeing them work in real time, you know, like things that we drill at the gym. Because so many, and it's getting better, but so many fighters don't drill. They want to spar. They want to hit pads. They want to do the fun things. They don't want to do the boring, the fundamentals. They don't want to do the footwork drills. They want to do the bag work. They don't want to do the partner drills. They don't want to do the situational things where you're just going through motions. But those are things that win fights.
Mm-hmm.
Hitting pads doesn't win fights. Sparring all the time doesn't win you fights.
Mm-hmm.
Drilling wins you fights. And so
that's
why I want to point that out because I think that it's just an important part of fighting and training is just fundamentals and drills and just letting them kind of your training take over whenever you get in the cage, you know?
Wow. Yeah, that was a good fight. Good. That was a good,
I wish
I thought he was going to try to work you or something. No, but I mean, just saying, I was like, well, maybe this one, he's going
to
probably,
I wish we had access to the fight I just had. Cause that guy was, that was a different fight. You know, those last few fights were quick. The last fight was a three round fight. You know, but
yeah, I don't think.
Oh, it's good. We can come back out next time. We can do it again. You know,
So and then real quick, jiu-jitsu. Any experience with jiu-jitsu?
Yeah.
Oh no, but how many or what belt or?
Dude, I've been.
I gotta show love to jiu-jitsu.
I've
been
a blue belt for like 7 years.
Oh wow.
Yeah, I've just never. I got a blue belt when I was back in Corpus, back in my home gym when I first started. We didn't have like a black belt in the gym, and there was another gym in a neighboring town that was a jiu-jitsu gym. And we kind of partnered with them. And so the black belt there kind of belted us. He basically watched us roll for an hour and just gave us belts. And he gave me a blue belt at the time. I was not a blue belt. But he gave me a blue belt, and I've had that blue belt since that day. So,
I would say you're a blue belt now.
I'll go to jiu-jitsu this evening. I got plenty of time. I could go to jiu-jitsu today. I've been trying to compete a lot in jiu-jitsu and grappling and stuff.
Yeah.
I did a super fight between my fights. I did a sub-hunter match I did a catch wrestling match in Austin.
Yeah.
Also, I've done a couple, do some jiu-jitsu tournaments. I've been trying to stay active between fights, grappling, and just to compete, yeah. but also just to up my grappling, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you have to keep that up.
And it was something my last fight I was able to show because I wrestled half the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I did a lot of wrestling and stuff in that fight and was doing a lot of, it was a true MMA fight. It wasn't a kickboxing fight. You know, we did a lot of on the floor, on the cage, on the feet. And I'm glad I've put all the time I've been putting in and continue to put in grappling because it has been my probably weakest point is jiu-jitsu because I have the least experience doing it of all the disciplines. But
yeah, because I don't know if I don't have interest in ever making it over, but I mean to jiu-jitsu. And but I mean I just feel
it's a phenomenal martial art. I always tell people if you can only learn one martial art, you have to pick one.
Yeah.
Do jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
It is incredibly applicable. You don't get hit in the head, so your brain's safe, you know?
Yeah.
It's just a great thing to learn, you know? It's a great sport. But
see, then that makes me feel like I'm crazy because then when I was at Paradigm, some of the jiu-jitsu guys were like, yo, man, I don't know what's up with you Muay Thai guys, man. Y'all guys.
Oh, people actually
say that. Yeah, you know how they say, they go, oh, man, y'all like that striking. Y'all like that striking each other and all that hitting the head. I mean, I ain't into that, man. I'm down with rolling around. I'm like, I go, man, I'm not even there yet, man, with the rolling around. I don't like rolling around that much. But
People dog on jiu-jitsu, and I'll be the first to say, I love jiu-jitsu. I love doing jiu-jitsu. It's an
oh, yeah, I respect
art.
It. I respect it.
It can be like watching paint dry.
Yeah.
Like it can be hard to watch sometimes, which is crazy to me. It's so popular.
Yeah.
Like we talk about Muay Thai is not popular. Like,
yeah.
In the States, like the jiu-jitsu is everywhere, but it's also so accessible.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
everywhere. Anyone can do it.
Yeah.
You can be, it doesn't reward you just for being a giant, jacked, strong dude. Like these nerds that come out and do jiu-jitsu or kill people. Like there's so many different ways to do it that it kind of allows for any body type, any style to do well. So
I mean, look at Mark Zuckerberg.
Yeah. Jiu-jitsu's great. You know, I prefer wrestling over at jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
But jiu-jitsu is a great, and it's a if you're going to fight, it's one you have to learn.
And then I always bring it up in the military. There's like, it really made me amazed because like in the military, you got a lot of guys from Midwest, different areas of America, and their class was wrestling in PE in school.
Wrestled. Yeah.
Going up in like, we didn't have that here in Texas. Like we didn't have it was none of these, either football, basketball, or baseball.
Yeah.
You know, one of the top three. Either that was the most thing at anything dealing with any neighborhood. I never knew about the wrestling. So then when I was there, I would see some dude like do something weird or something. And then I was always just kind of like, I mean, we would wrestle, but like I said, it would take a turn because then one guy would do something crazy, man. I was like, what the hell? He's like, oh, dude, I practice jiu-jitsu, but I was a wrestler.
Yeah.
But I switched over to jiu-jitsu before I joined the Navy. I'm like, oh, okay.
And that happens. A lot of people do that. Like,
yeah.
Like, I didn't get wrestled in high school either. I really wish I could have. So I know a lot of people who did. It's always a great.
Yeah.
A cool thing. And that's the thing too, like in the gym, all the guys, all my training partners I have, we have a lot of killers. The guys that are the biggest headaches to train with are the guys that you know can wrestle. Because at any point, they're going to be on your legs, on your hips, trying to grab you, and you have to get away from doing anything else. You know, if you want to strike with them, you got to get separation. It's a hard, hard thing to do. We had a guy, Gino Morelli, was an All-American from Penn State. We trained in the gym for a while. He moved back home some months ago. He's got I think he's 2-0. He actually fought for PCS. And then he came back and fought for Fury, I think. Now he's fighting Fury as well. Good dude. Really good dude. Love him. I've never been manhandled like that. Like you can't move him. It's another.
Yeah.
Another level of wrestling. Another guy, Cody Freeman, that at the gym, that guy can wrestle.
Wow.
You know, so I've had to deal with some.
Yeah, and then, I mean, that would be interesting to have maybe a wrestler on here one day, because I have a lot of questions about that, too, because it's just,
yeah, it's just, I don't know. Like, yeah, I feel like the more on your belt, the better, you know?
Oh, and for then, sure. Yeah.
And then also I hear, well, I mean, I know we're getting deeper and deeper, but there was another thing I hear too. Like sometimes fundamentals from other sports kind of messes with the MMA sometimes, because then you can't shake your,
it can't, well,
you
like,
can't shake
like,
some bad habits that
like
you learn
wrestlers
when you're young. Yeah.
Typically, they come into striking and they're heavy in the lead leg. They're kind of stiff. They stand kind of square. Like you do, like you'll, yeah.
It's natural for them. Yeah, and it's not their fault. It's just like
no,
in their natural.
The were,
yeah, it's just the way they started off.
Yeah, the way they started off. Yeah. You know, it just is. It was like I have things I did in Muay Thai that I had to change for MMA. That's another thing too. Is like the transition from any martial art to MMA. Mm-hmm. If you're doing an individual thing and doing MMA, is you have to change. Like, you cannot be the same. Where it's boxing, kickboxing, Muay Thai, Taekwondo, wrestling, Jiu-Jitsu. Like you have to make changes because the rule sets change.
Yeah.
You know, so when I first started focusing on MMA from Muay Thai, it didn't work. It'd be too tall. I was too still. Like I didn't have good head movement. Cause you don't utilize the things the same way you do in a Muay Thai fight.
Yeah.
You do an MMA fight.
Yeah.
So you have to be able to, no matter what your base is, use the best parts from that and then adapt everything else to work for MMA.
Yeah.
You know, it's truly a different sport.
But I feel at the end of the day, man, I mean, people, a lot of people like to say, oh, fighters are just this and that. I'm like, nah, bro, like you actually got to be kind of smart.
Yeah. Well, you got
like a lot of things you got to remember when you're doing things like,
yeah.
And then you're like, you got to turn this off, turn that on. Like, okay, I got to do this, do that. And this is all like milliseconds, not even milliseconds, that you're just reacting, which just goes into your training, you know?
Yeah.
So that's awesome.
Yeah. No, it is. You have a bunch of people who fight. You've got, like, you know, people who high school dropouts and stuff like that. And you've got doctors and lawyers, you know?
Yeah.
It's everything in between, which is so cool about it. It's super inclusive to kind of everybody.
Yeah.
You know?
That's what I love about the whole fighting thing, because at the end of the day, I mean, I hate to put it, you know, I mean, either you're big, small, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how can I put it? Just if you're active, you're prepared.
Yeah.
You have a little bit better of a chance, whether you're big or small or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
Versus if you have no experience at all.
It's about preparation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And things like that, you know.
I mean, I just feel, if I ever had any kids, I mean, I would have taught them from the get-go, you know, just to train. You know, or just, you know, little things, because I feel it just builds up discipline, you know?
Yeah. Well, I think it's no matter what you do, like try and do it well, like work hard at it where you can do it well. You know, that's the best thing you can, that's the best, like no matter what you go into, that's probably the best kind of rule to kind of go by.
There was this guy that would go into Paradigm and he was known for going in there drunk. And
that's not worse.
No, it wasn't. Not in Muay Thai. Because then we would spar. And then it was one of those things where sometimes you'd just be like,
and just smell it.
It's just because you sweated. So you're just like, like there's this one dude. And then I would just be like, yo, man, like who the fuck has a beer here, you know? And then I kind of like brains, I was like, but I just always felt like, yo, man, it ain't my place. And then finally I heard, like, within time, the coach caught him. And, like, called him out. Like, and then got in his ass. Like, what the fuck, you know?
Yeah.
Like, why are you doing that? But my point was that guy, I hate to say it, man. I mean, sometimes I'll have to, like, kind of lean. I mean, when we have sparring on Fridays, I have to kind of turn it down a little bit because I feel sorry for this dude, man. Because sometimes, but it explained. I was like, I knew he was drunk sometimes. He would go in there and he would spar and he was consistent.
Yeah.
He would go in there consistently. It's just that he would go in there and then sometimes I would just see that. I guess that's what you get like when you're drunk and trying to spar, you know?
Yeah.
You get somebody who's totally lacking, bro. If anything, that's the wrong thing to do before you're going to have somebody hit you.
I can't imagine that being very beneficial to your game.
But I took it to heart just knowing to myself, like, yo, I'm going to just turn it down a little because I don't want to hurt like this dude. He's keeping himself open, this and that. And I know we're not supposed to hit hard. We're just for technique, whatever. But then some guys would take advantage of him, man.
Yeah.
And then like kind of wear on him. And then they're coming to find out that was why. Because he was drunk.
Maybe he learned.
So, Jacob, man. So I guess that we can end it there, bro. Right at 2 hours.
Two hours.
Hell yeah, man.
Cool. Man.
Hell yeah,
awesome.
Bro.
Glad so, I got to come out.
Nah, man. You got to see it. Now you know where you're at. Now you know where it's at. Definitely. Thank you for coming by.
For sure.
Thank
man.
You for talking to me about, you know, your journey and the journey that's still continuing. Mm. I'm excited for you. I wish you all the best, man.
Thanks, man.
Dude, that's awesome, bro. And like I said, yet again, thank you for coming.
For sure, man.
Definitely going to turn this one around very quick so I can get it out there. And we'll see what happens on UFC this weekend.
We'll find out. If I was wrong about where here's the camera. If I was wrong about my predictions, you can DM me and say what you want. I'll own up to it. But I stand by my picks.
And then we're definitely going to have Jacob on again. So I know that for a fact.
Yeah,
so,
I'd love to
so
come back out.
Definitely, man. And then definitely maybe bring Paul.
Yeah, I need to bring Paul up, man. I love Paul.
So that'd be cool. Like I said, I'm open for two other. I mean, if you wanted to bring, two other people, that'd be perfect and talk about fighting, whatever.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I've got. If you want to talk about fighting, I got some friends I can bring and talk about fighting.
Yeah,
so we can
definitely.
Make that
yeah.
Happen.
Oh no, I'm in. I'm in. Yeah.
For
and then
sure.
And then we'll plan it.
Yep. Awesome, man.
All right, Jacob. Appreciate it, bro.
Awesome, man.